And I was thinking about all the people I've had on the show and all the people I follow on Twitter who really never gave up on hammering Cuomo for being so incompetent. And one of those people is Councilman Joe Borelli. Thank you so much for joining us, Joe.
Oh, thanks for having me all this time, especially on this issue that's been so crazy for so many families in New York.
Do you feel vindicated, Joe? Are you surprised that this this woman, DeRosa, kind of dropped the bomb?
I mean, it's amazing to think what people believe they can get away with behind closed doors in 2021, where everything is being recorded, everyone's kind of out to get you, there's no more loyalty.
Right.
She comes from a long family of insider lobbyists. They probably have a code of omerta or something within them. But when you go out into a Democratic conference of 150 people on a call, not everyone's going to be on the same page. And whoever the nameless leaker is, kudos to them and God bless them. And to some of the Democratic elected officials who went on record in the first article of the New York Post and said, this is crazy, this is enough, good, I'm glad they did. I wish they did more. I wish they did it sooner. But I'm glad they came out and said how ridiculous some of this stuff was. And it is ridiculous. These are people who knowingly conspired to withhold evidence because they thought the federal Department of Justice was investigating them.
But Joe, can I just stop you there for one second? I hate to interrupt you. We also have to be clear. They were afraid that Donald Trump was going to tweet mean things about them, too. And that was a big part
of it. Very deadly. Very dead. And he did anyway, which is the amazing part. But the DOJ, the nonpartisan DOJ, career people of the DOJ, sent letters of inquiry requesting data on thousands of people who were actually dying, right? This is not a pie-in-the-sky thing. This is not the DOJ, investigating some claim of a nasty tweet somewhere in Peoria. This is the death of thousands of people, and they're investigating, just like our own attorney general here is investigating as well. And they didn't want to comply. They didn't want to release the information. They didn't want to have egg on their face, so they tried to cover up. This is what bad people do. A lot of Democrats around the country happen to be bad governors, bad mayors, wrong on a lot of issues. That's fine. The difference is Governor Cuomo and his staff, his top people, are bad people because bad people cover up mistakes that led to the deaths of thousands of people. Period. Full stop.
And Joe, you mentioned that you're surprised that she said that and didn't know it was going to get leaked out. And I agree. I'm like one of the most paranoid people on the planet. But I also think it says a lot about the arrogance of this administration, that they never think that maybe some of these Democrat politicians are going to stand up and say, this is gross. Like, you guys are apologizing not for the deaths of all these people and not for lying about it, but for putting us in a politically inconvenient situation.
And it's very interesting because the Cuomo administration's response was to release the full transcript, which didn't save their gal, but it did show the difference among some elected officials. There were some elected officials who were upset because they had to go out and defend Cuomo with all these nasty rumors. This one particular woman, Senator Rachel May, was upset because people in her district were asking her to investigate the governor, which is part of her actual job as oversight. And that's what she was upset about. There were some other legislators who actually said, no, this is crazy. I mean, the chair of the Assembly's Health Committee actually said, there's not enough hours in the day to explain why you're full of crap. I mean, he basically said to the administration. And again, other ones just said, no, we're just unhappy that we have to be on the same team as you because you messed up so bad.
And I'm talking to Joe Borelli, the New York City councilman. I want to ask you, too, because I know the nursing home story is rightfully getting a lot of coverage, and I'm so happy about it. But there's other stories coming out now that Bill de Blasio really thinks that some of these powers have to be reined back from King Cuomo, and a lot of industries, including restaurant industries, are saying this guy did more than just, hurt the nursing homes. He really, really hurt the economy in kind of a vicious way.
Yeah, and it was all politically motivated. It was also that, hopefully in his mind, other states would catch up into the number of deaths. Hopefully he wouldn't look so bad. Hopefully his cases won't expand. And all he did was make every effort possible to have the strictest regulation, the strictest lockdowns, and have no urgency on reopening everything. That crushed people's livelihoods. And we have nothing to show for it because New York didn't perform best with these lockdowns. they actually still performed among the worst states in the United States for deaths, hospitalizations, and overall cases. So we have nothing to show for it, but for the fact that our governor thought he could, you know, get some positive media attention, maybe sell some books, maybe make some posters, you know, ham it up with his brother on Cuomo primetime. Again, bad people do this. Not good people who have the wrong policies or the wrong decisions, who aren't that competent. Bad people act like this.
And his level of just, you know, braggadocio about every single thing he did. I have to play you this cut right here. This is cut 25. This is Andrew Cuomo.
I put my head on the pillow at night saying I saved lives. That's how I sleep at night.
Does that amaze you, Joe? It kind of amazes me.
I mean, it's not amazing if you've seen like a movie like American Psycho and you understand what people who have like sociopathic tendencies have. I mean, this is a guy who lives in an alternate reality. I mean, he was at the White House today in the Oval Office, you know, acting as though he was part of the big victory Biden team with COVID. We're going to save the day. And of course, the Biden people had to prevent the media from even taking any questions because all of the questions would have been about Andrew Cuomo. And rightfully so. Why is the president having this disaster of a policymaker in to advise the president and other lawmakers about what to do in COVID? I mean, he should be writing the book on what not to do in all reality. And yet here we are.
Sorry, Joe, but I was just going to say, Dr. Fauci, too, was one of the people who said that New York was the model and that, you know, Cuomo did everything right. So when are we going to get apologies from these people?
Or the ones that said DeSantis did everything wrong. I mean,
right.
Whereas, you know, Governor DeSantis' state has fewer deaths, fewer hospitalizations, fewer cases, less of an economic burden that the state has to now bear. Their budget revenues aren't so bad. Their tax revenues haven't fallen. All this Governor DeSantis did. And his people are actually getting vaccinated right now. Whereas everything Governor Cuomo, he has the opposite of the Midas touch. Everything he touches turns to garbage, basically.
No, I totally agree. And I do have to wonder, do you think Chris Cuomo is going to go near this story at all on primetime? Is he going to get after it?
I mean, I would love to think he is, but I can't imagine him doing that. I mean, the stories first started to break about this nursing home scandal in late May. And that was conveniently the very same week he hammed it up with him with the now famous giant Q-tip. This isn't a serious person. This isn't a serious interview. And Cuomo has consistently stonewalled the local press by controlling who asks questions and pre-screening the questions, that this is probably one of the few opportunities where he was actually on a primetime television show with an open series of questions that could have been answered. But because it was actually his brother doing the interviews, it was basic questions and let's make some shtick over your giant ugly nose.
And let's talk about Mom's Meatballs. I remember that little stand-up they did, too. I guess my other question for you is, it seems like the press now, they have to keep pretending to be journalists. And it's hard to keep that up once Trump's gone, because he's the only one they really have a passion for taking down. So I've started to notice that they're shifting that direction towards Cuomo and towards the Lincoln Project. And it's like these sacrificial lambs who they kept them alive while they needed them politically. And now they're kind of like, okay, well, we'll attack Andrew Cuomo to keep the light off Joe Biden.
Yeah, well, it's like that famous brace yourself meme of Ned Stark from Game of Thrones, where it's brace yourself for a storm of, look, we also covered the Cuomo scandal way back when they might have wrote a single little article on page 7 about, hey, there's a nursing home question in New York. And that's what you're going to see. You're going to see people try to save their own skin as verified journalists and just ignoring the fact that other than the New York Post and the Wall Street Journal, other than those two publications, no national news organization at all asked Andrew Cuomo any serious questions about something that was growing in severity for months.
Joe, and I've asked you this before, and you're the councilman in New York City, and I do want to ask, what do you see for the future of New York? I was on, so there's this new app, Clubhouse, and you can join in and you can hear what people have to say. And I was on one yesterday, and I'm not from New York, so I don't know why I even joined it, but it was all of these New Yorkers talking about whether or not they think it's going to make a comeback or whether they think people are going to leave. And I want your take because you would know better than anyone else.
Yeah, look, I mean, politics is downstream of culture, and there is no cultural hierarchy in New York without SNL being on top of that. And SNL did a spoof this weekend about Zillow, and they sort of framed it in a joke as though Zillow was the new porn for 30-somethings. And I can tell you with certainty, the 30-somethings I hang out with use Zillow at night for some of the same ecstatic purposes one would do with pornography, and we just sit and browse all the ways we want to leave New York. It's a really interesting commentary on what people in middle age are now thinking in New York City and their future of residing here. They don't want to, and it's a joke now.
Yeah, no, I didn't see that skit, but that actually sounds kind of funny. I'm shocked from SNL. Maybe I'll look at that on the other side. Joe, thank you so much for joining us. Please join us again soon with more updates. Joe Borelli is always keeping people up to date on what's going on with New York and with Governor Cuomo and with Bill de Blasio. He has his hands full. There's so many boobs in New York right now. Joe, where can people follow you on Twitter?
At Joe Borelli NYC. And thank you very much, Grace.
Perfect. Thank you so much. Oh, man. You know what? It's been a tough year for a lot of people. And sometimes you just got to find the silver lining. And one silver lining I got to say is that as bad as Baker is, I think Cuomo is worse. Because he was like comparing himself to like Robert De Niro and Al Pacino. And I can laugh about it now because I feel like justice is being served, like I've said today. But for a while, it was very, very heartbreaking for people like Janice Dean, who had to watch this guy basically take a victory lap after their in-laws or parents or grandparents died.
Well, it's kind of like you said last week. Like, I mean, Charlie Baker may have bungled things up, but he's not sociopathic in the way that Cuomo is. Like Baker, you know, he looked at the Holyoke home and he was like, okay, yeah, that was bad. You know, Cuomo was just like, no, nothing happened there. I didn't do it.
Yeah,
what
Charlie Baker
about?
Didn't come out and
stop
say,
being a liar.
People died. What do you want me to say?
Yeah.
It's like, oh my gosh. Guys, I have great news for my listeners. The Gen 40 heater is back and just in time for the really cold temps. It is getting very, very chilly out. And you don't want to heat your whole house up. It's very expensive. Like Jared said, the prices are just skyrocketing.
Yeah, it was one. The real feel was 1 degree this morning.
Ugh, it's so
brutal.
It was
awful. But the Gen 40 heater
makes it less brutal.
Absolutely. The bedroom was nice and warm.
You need to start planning, and that means you need the Gen 40 heater. Robert from the Cape says it is remarkable. No other heater I've ever used is like this. And it's a good looking heater. It's not clunky and it's very safe, which I know a lot of people get nervous with heaters that they're going to catch fire or something like that. This is a very safe heater, so you don't have to worry. The Eden Pure Gen 40 makes you feel warmer than your furnace. It also costs less to run. So here's what you have to do. Go to EdenPure.com and put in code word HOWIEDEAL to get $50 off the sale price. That's EdenPure.com and use code word HOWIEDEAL for an extra $50 off. These heaters are in high demand, so go right now to EdenPure.com. I'm going to open up the phone lines probably for the last bit of the show till we have Howie Carr on because I think it's Friday. People have a lot they want to say. Call in 844-500-4242. We'll be right back. This is the Grace Curley Show.
She's never held office, but she paid the Whiskey Priest's monthly rent once. She's Grace Curley.